Hi, let's talk about the structure of the heart. And let's begin with the layers of the heart wall. On the left here, we can see the heart having most of the pericardium reflected away. So what you're seeing here is the fibrous pericardium with the parietal layer of the serous pericardium reflected back. And then the immediate surface of the heart is a layer called the epicardium, which is the visceral layer of the serous pericardium. Deep to that epicardium, we'll have epicardial fat, as we can see throughout here. We'll also have some blood vessels. I can see a couple taking a rather tortuous route deep to that epicardium. On the right here, we can see a dissected heart with that epicardium removed, and we can see some of those vascular elements that would have cruised along deep to the epicardium. But more importantly, we can see a very robust myocardium. The myomuscle cardium is the muscular layer of the heart. This is what allows the heart to relax and probably more importantly, contract or go through, periods of diastole and systole to really serve as a pump for the blood. That endocardium is then lined, the myocardium is then lined by endocardium, which covers the internal surface of the heart, including the cusps of the valves. And we can see some elaborations of that here. So these are trabeculocarni meaty beams found within the ventricles. Here we can also see a papillary muscle, this anterior papillary muscle, which is an extension of the myocardium, but still covered by endocardium. And in this atrium here, we can see these pectinate muscles. Again, that's myocardium, but it's still covered by endocardium. So let's look at the structures which are peculiar to the various chambers of the heart. And let's start with the right atrium, because let's just pretend like we're blood returning back from systemic circulation. There is our superior vena cava there, SVC. That's draining everything superior to the diaphragm. Coming down, this is our inferior vena cava, IVC. Here's a little bit of that inferior vena cava there. That vessel is draining all of the tissues inferior to the diaphragm. We can see this smooth-walled area. This is all called the sinus venarum. And it is separated by the pectinate muscle here by this very lovely ridge of tissue. That ridge of tissue is called the crista terminalis. And it's at the superior point of that ridge of tissue where the SA node is going to live. Let's take a different look at that right atrium. This is more of a right surface look. You can still see the superior vena cava. Here's the inferior vena cava. And here is a very nice interatrial septum. And right about there is the fossa ovalis, a remnant of the foramen ovale. So in utero, there's two septa, a primary and a secondary septum, which are parted, and there is a space between them called the foramen ovale, the oval window, through which oxygen-rich blood coming from the placenta can pass from the right atrium to the left atrium so that it may bypass the pulmonary circuit of circulation. We can also see a little flap here. This has kind of been reflected away ever so slightly, and just beyond that is the opening for the coronary sinus, or the coronary sinus os. As we go a little superior to that along this ridge would be the region where the AV node will live. So that's the atrioventricular node, kind of where the interatrial septum meets the atrioventricular septum. The right atrial serves as a pass-through conduit for blood into the right ventricle. Here is the opening for the right ventricle, or for the tricuspid valve. Tricuspid valve has three cusps. It has an anterior cusp, it has a posterior cusp, and it has a septal cusp. That septal cusp is largely immobile, so in function, the tricuspid valve works more as a bicuspid valve. We can even see some of the chordae tendineae of the right ventricle. Let's get a better look at it there. So here is that tricuspid valve, and here are those chordae tendineae coming down to the anterior papillary muscle. There are three cusps and three papillary muscles. There isn't any fidelity between the two, so all of the chordae tendineae from the anterior cusp don't go to the anterior papillary muscle. That anterior papillary muscle is the largest of the papillary muscles, and it is associated with this beauty, which has been incised, which is called the septomarginal trabecula. The septomarginal trabecula, or the moderator band, would cut across from the interventricular septum and allow the preponderance of the right bundle branch to cut across to the anterior papillary muscle and the walls of the right ventricle. We can also kind of see some of the chordae tendineae, maybe some in there as well, but we'll get a better view of those when we get to the left ventricle. In this region here, is known as the conus arteriosus, or the infundibulum. It's the smooth area that is leading blood up to the pulmonary valve, which is proximal to the pulmonary trunk. So here is our lovely view of the heart valves. Here is our pulmonary trunk. Here is our ascending aorta. Then we have our tricuspid and our bicuspid. So this would be the pulmonary valve and the aortic valve. So pulmonary valve is the anteriormost vessel that we can see. Looking at the left ventricle, the best view is going to be from the posterior, so this is the base of the heart, which has been incised, and we can see some very lovely pulmonary veins there. These are delivering oxygen-rich blood back to the heart from the lungs. Here we can see a little bit of that left auricle, and within it, some of the pectinate muscle. And the fossa ovalis is going to be obscured here by this portion of the base of the heart. My apologies for that. Here's a better view with that reflected away, and we can see the fossa ovalis located there. So blood is going to flow through the left atrium, through the bicuspid valve, which has anterior and posterior cusps, also called the mitral valve. This is what is blood is passing through between the left atrium and the left ventricle, and it's what closes to maintain the forward movement of blood from the left ventricle out the ascending aorta and aortic valve. So here's a view of the left ventricle. This is a rather bizarre view of the heart. So let's see what we can see here to identify things. Here's the pulmonary trunk. There is the ascending aorta. Here's the superior vena cava. There is a pulmonary vein there. Here is that interventricular septum. Here's an anterior papillary muscle. We can see lots of chordae tendony going to that muscle. Here is the posterior papillary muscle, also with lots of chordae tendony. And we have a very lovely view there and there of the trabeculae carnei, the meaty beams, that robust myocardium of the left ventricle. Blood from the left ventricle is destined for systemic circulation, and so it is going to leave the aortic valve, which has a right cusp, a left cusp, and a posterior, also known as a non-coronary cusp. And these cusps are going to close during diastole because pressure in the aorta is going to be greater than pressure in the left ventricle. And when that happens, blood is going to then flow into these coronary arteries. There's the right coronary artery, and there is the left coronary artery. So we've discussed the various structures of the heart as well as the structure of the heart, and we've gone chamber by chamber, discussing the features which are peculiar to each chamber and the vessels and valves that are associated with each chamber. Thank you very much for your time.